in today's tough topic, we're going to talk about something that's I genuinely feel like in the Christian community it's kind of been downplayed and really hasn't been adequately answered. And I feel like in the non-Christian world it's kind of been overly complicated. And my purpose in this is to try and help bring healing and to help bring kind of a more fair treatment of it. Now, for obvious reasons, I'm not going to go too in-depth about stuff because I don't want to cause problems with the video. I want to bring healing with the video. And obviously, you know, that's complicated because this is a complicated issue. So the first thing is, you know, the acknowledgement of the problem. Because, I mean, if you talk to Christians, you know, this is a cut and dry, black and white case. And if you talk to non-Christians, you know, this is so complicated that it's like there's no answer in sight. And everybody just kind of picks and chooses their own sexuality and there's really no standard for anything. And so I feel like, first off, Christians need to stop ignoring that there is a problem. You know, the Christian answer to human sexuality has always been, well, not always, but for a good deal of time, the answer to human sexuality has been to just ignore it. You know, Song of Solomon, a book about human sexuality, you know, is then completely ignored. And no, it can't be about it. It can't be about that. No. So instead, they make it all about, make it all about, you know, God's love for people, and I don't know, it gets weird. You know, and the truth is, Song of Solomon is a book about human sexuality. And the Bible is full of examples of God dealing with human sexuality. You know, I feel like it's something that can't just be ignored. And because Christianity has ignored these issues for so long, it hasn't even listened to non-Christians' opinions, it's really put a wall between us and the world. Now, I'm not saying you have to compromise on biblical morality. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that sometimes issues aren't as simple as we make them out to be. So, let's start with the standard. The standard of sexuality is that there is a male and there's a female. This is, you know, the genetics, okay? XX being female, excuse me, and XY being male. This is the standard. In a perfect world, you know, everybody would be born male or female, and everything would be great. However, we don't live in a perfect world. it's very much so not perfect. You know, and so the whole idea that sex is only determined by genetics, that's really what the debate is all about. Is it true that our sex is only governed by our genetics? Now, if you asked me this a year or two ago, I would have said, yes, absolutely, our sex is only determined by our genetics. But that's a very naive answer, and I don't really feel like it addresses the problems that the world is having in trying to find out their own sexuality. And good girl. And so that takes us to kind of the second idea here, is that there is an abnormality. there is something that is breaks away from that standard. I mean, people are born with different genetic, you know, problems all the time. You know, people are born blind, people are born with Down syndrome, people are born with, you know, different things like that that really, ideally, that's not the standard. You know, we have two eyes and that's supposed to allow us to be able to see, but people are still born blind. So I mean, we can't deny that there is an abnormality. Jeez. And we can't deny that there is an abnormality. You know, there is a break from that standard. My dog's hair all over me. that, you know, there is that difference from the standard. And that's something that we can't just keep denying that it doesn't exist, can't just keep hiding from. That's something we absolutely have to admit, and we have to deal with it. There are physical defects. I know one girl who, technically speaking, is a male if you look at genetics, because she has the XY. Okay, now here's the problem. When she was born, or, you know, I should say when she was a baby, to make things simple, her body didn't really process the different things like it should, and I really don't want to get too into this. My purpose isn't to talk to the doctors. My purpose is to talk to regular people. And so her body didn't really process like it should. And so for all intents and purposes, she's a woman because, okay, hold on now. She has the body of a female. Okay, even though she doesn't have a uterus, she has a technically a vagina. And because her balls didn't descend and her penis didn't form because her body didn't process the information like it was supposed to. So her body is, her physique is feminine and she appears to have a vagina. Now, obviously, she doesn't really have a fully functional vagina because she doesn't have the uterus and all that stuff, but she doesn't have a penis. See, so then it brings up the problem. This is obviously, this is an abnormality. People are, not everybody is born like this, but it does still exist. So what about those people? Should she identify as a male or as a female? And that's the problem. Really complicated. Now, if we go with the traditional response, genetics is the only deciding factor, well, that doesn't make much sense because if she tried to have sex with a woman, that wouldn't happen. that wouldn't be a thing. And in fact, we wouldn't know that she's not a woman if we lived a couple hundred years ago. See what I mean? And as far as character, she functions as a woman. And I mean, she's married to a man. She's Christian, you know, but the traditional line doesn't really fit in this circumstance. Now, obviously, the abnormality is not the standard. However, there is still an abnormality. And that's my point, is acknowledging that there is an abnormality. So let's look at transgender for an issue, and I'm trying to tie this all in, so deal with me. Transgender can apply to many different ideas. Some people think that there's kind of like a third gender, and these would be the transgender people. You know, they're not really traditionally male or female. They're just kind of like this third thing out there. And then another idea is that they identify inside contrary to what their physical is, be it their genetics or be it their appearance. Either of those, they just don't identify as that. They feel like they're something else. So there's a few different factors to look at. The first is oftentimes we believe that we are males are effeminate by, their hobbies or their character. Maybe a guy is overly soft-spoken. Maybe he's overly gentle. Maybe he gets into things that are traditionally said to be feminine. That doesn't necessarily make you feminine. It just means that you have a different standard of taste than regular people have. I mean, it's just like a girl who doesn't want to be the princess but wants to be like a tomboy. See what I mean? That's just acknowledging the fact that there's diversity in us. That's not saying that there is a different gender that's going on. You know, and I think that sometimes because of the lack of understanding on this that we just kind of go with mystical approaches. You know, and so my idea is to break through the mystical, the emotional, and break through into more of a scientific approach. The second factor is feeling. Sometimes we don't feel like we are what we are, be it mental, be it, you know, whatever. There's just kind of like this nagging sensation that we aren't actually, if you're a male, that you're not a male, that you're something else. You feel like you're something else. You don't feel comfortable in the male skin, if you will. And then that brings us to kind of a third factor, that there is no scientific proof that there is anything other than male or female. Obviously, that would the person who supports transgender would have the idea that, well, that's because it's not a scientific issue, it's more of a philosophical one. But you have to remember that philosophy has to be based off of something. And science gives us an answer to that. I'm not talking about religion, I'm talking about science. Science shows that there's really, there's two things there. Now, however, in studying things like, you know, psychology and whatnot, we can become very aware of mental illnesses where people believe themselves to be something that they're not. Now, for this, I think there's actually a great cruelty that's going on right now because the Christians refuse to answer transgender people and the world refuses to help them. Instead, there's this idea that you have to accept this. Well, if I believed myself to be a tree, no matter how hard I believed it to be true, I wouldn't be a tree. And I would genuinely hope that you would help me get the help that I need. You know? And I really feel like a lot of times that's what's going on. People, you know, having a mental issue that they need to work through, that they need to figure out, that because they can't go to the church or else they'll be looked down on and shunned. They can't go to the world because the world has a very ambiguous, undefined sexuality. It's something that is very hard to know what to believe and what not to believe, especially in our culture, because our culture is completely relative. If you want something to be true, then it is. It makes no difference about whether it is or isn't true. If it's true for you, it's good enough for me, and I just have to accept that. And that's not really how we should be treating this, because if it is a mental illness, we need to be helping them, not condoning mental illness. This is something that I really feel like we've lost all sanity on this. And obviously, we are molded by our culture, but we also mold our culture. There is a back and forth that kind of happens. And although it is a complicated issue, we don't need to make it more complicated by saying, you know, all these different things. A false belief doesn't substantiate reality. Okay, reality is reality. And we have to kind of mash our beliefs up with that. Okay, if I'm driving down the highway, and the road sign says that the speed limit is 65 miles per hour. I can say, well, I identify that they're saying that's more of a suggestion, and I'm going to go 80 because I really don't feel like there's that big of a difference between, you know, that 15 miles per hour difference. Well, then I get pulled over by a police officer, and he says, no, you don't self-identify with whatever you want. There's a standard. And really all of reality is based on the idea that there is a standard, right? You know, you go to work to make money to pay for rent. That's kind of a reality. Now, you can deny that you have to pay rent, but at the end of the day, that is still the fact of reality, that you do have to pay. You do have to do something to get money. You do have to do something to get food. You know, this is the reality around us. Denying it is unscientific and very unhelpful. I can deny that it's daytime, but it is still daytime. You know what I mean? There is still intended meaning and an actual meaning. You know, there is still reality. And to deny reality for the sake of, if that's what you want to believe, that's okay, that's not helpful to somebody who's genuinely struggling with their sexuality. So that kind of brings us towards a solution. Now, I want to say towards a solution because it's a complicated issue. And I genuinely don't believe that there is one single easy fix to the problem. So with that in mind, let me go towards a solution that I believe is biblical and I believe is fair, but not really necessarily. Here's the thing. When there's an emotional problem, oftentimes we don't really care about what facts are. We just want to believe something that gives us comfort. So we'll throw caution to the wind all for the sake of being accepted and being comfortable. You know, and I'm not necessarily saying anything for or against that. It's just we would rather not change. We would rather people just accept us for who we are. And that's kind of that's a good thing to accept people, but it's not a good thing to give way to uncertainty and just complete chaos. But of course, if you live in America, you know that everything is about uncertainty and chaos. Everybody just throws knowledge to the wind. I mean, it's really just you decide your own reality, and if that's good for you, it's good for me, and I'm just going to accept that. But that gets into a whole realm of philosophy, and obviously just the inability of relative morality. It's an impossibility. Now, keep in mind, I'm not talking about morality so far. I'm talking about physical existence. I'm talking about the fact that, yes, there are people who feel like they are male when they are actually female. There are people who feel like they are female when they are male. There are people who feel like they are something else than male or female. There are people who are not born physically according to the standard. That's something that is fact. These are not issues of morality or religion. These are issues of scientific fact. Just as we're talking about scientific fact, that you cannot prove that there is such a thing as a third gender. I mean, you're dealing with philosophical issues that are based on relative reasoning. It doesn't have any basis, scientific or otherwise. So, first off, in every system, the exception doesn't make the rule. It doesn't matter what we're talking about. The exception never makes the rule. The exception is the exception to the rule. In other words, the exception to the standard. So if I have a physical abnormality or a mental delusion, I guess, for lack of a better word. I don't really like that word, but we'll roll with it just for a second. Roll with me here. That doesn't mean that that defines the standard. I'm not a male because I feel like a male. I am a male because I either am or I'm not a male. So then it becomes, well, what happens when my physical is not so easily defined, like in the case of that woman? For that, there's a simple answer that I hopefully isn't too simple. Genetics overall is the standard. However, there is a break from that, in which case you have to go by appearance. In the case of my friend, for instance, where genetically she's a man, but appearance she's a female because her body didn't work like it was supposed to, and that abnormality caused her to not grow the male appearance, and so she grew up as a female. And, you know, I really don't think that that's anything wrong, you know, with that, moral or otherwise. Because, once again, people who lived 200 years ago, you know, they would have done the exact same thing. I'm a woman. Why? Because I'm a woman. Like, they didn't even know about genes and that kind of stuff, you know, however many years ago. Obviously, I'm not trying to be precise about dates, you know, obviously. But in most of these cases, there usually is a dominant trait. Not always, but usually. Like, they'll have the vagina, but then a partially formed penis. In which case, there are many options, you know, such as abstinence, for instance. And I'm not trying to make this overly simplistic. You know, I realize that it is difficulty. But the standard seems to be this, that genetics decide who we are, male or female. But then there are abnormalities. Now, these abnormalities should not be treated as making new standards. They should be treated as an abnormal development in humanity and in human sexuality, in which case you would have to go to the appearance. And then the last factor in all this would be your feelings. See, if you are genetically a male and you look like a male, well then if you feel like a female, you need to get mental help because you are a male. If you are genetically a male but appear as a female, that's where it gets a little bit more complicated. And it appears to be that the answer would then be that you are a female. So that brings up the question, so appearance trumps genetics? No. We're not talking about the standard. We're talking about the abnormal. Genetics says male, but the physical development did not develop, for lack of a better word, as it should have. It developed as a female, even though it was supposed to have processed the information as a male. See what I mean? You have to remember the standard and then move to the abnormal. You have to view the abnormal development in light of the standard, okay? Down syndrome. Are they not a person? No, absolutely they are a person. Absolutely they are a person. The standard is this is what their genes are supposed to look like. There was a break in that, something that was abnormal in their development, and they are still a person. Now, obviously, it would be a little bit easier to to categorize them as a male or a female, but still, you have to look at it in the same lens, that there's a standard, and then the abnormal is viewed in light of the standard, okay? And then feelings come last, okay? This is extremely important because if we are to have any resemblance of order, of sanity, there has to be a standard. And, for instance, who's to say that a child molester isn't wrong? Well, there is no standard. Why not? Why not? Maybe you're wrong, and maybe you just need to accept them for who they are. Who's to say that a murderer is wrong? See, I mean, well, there has to be a standard of some kind, right? You shouldn't murder people, right? That's something that God shouldn't have to tell you. That's just something that you should know. You should forgive people, not people who deserve it. You should forgive people because you don't want to be a bitter, messed up person. That's just how it is. You shouldn't abuse children. These are things that religion aside should be standards. Now, obviously, religion, modern morality owes itself and is indebted towards religion. Absolutely. You know, that's just a fact of life. If there was no religious development, there'd be no moral development. absolutely the idea that there is a reason to do something and to not do something. That there's a reason why Ted Bundy was wrong. Not because he got caught, but because it was wrong to do what he did. That there is a standard. And that's what I'm talking about, that there is a standard in human sexuality, and we have to look at the abnormalities in light of that standard. Okay? And then feelings come last. But the problem is, in today's culture, we've kind of flip-flopped and said, okay, whatever you feel, that's whatever you are. And it's not like that. So then people are getting medical procedures done to conform them to how they feel at that time. Well, there's a lot of problems with that. First off, feelings come and go. Excuse me. Second off, you might just have, chemical imbalances going on. Is that third off? It might just be you have a softer character than is traditional. There's a lot of things like that. But our feelings can't really decide reality. If you're married, that sometimes you're tempted to cheat on your spouse. Does that mean that you should cheat on your spouse? No, you shouldn't cheat on your spouse. Because our feelings don't decide what is and isn't right, right? And it's the same kind of a standard with human sexuality. Now, here's the kicker, though. Christians need to do a better job of accepting people, especially sexually confused people. Okay, just because someone is sexually confused doesn't mean we should instantly pass judgment. I mean, goodness sakes, help them find themselves, for goodness sakes. And if you are someone who is transgender, something like that, or maybe a Christian who's just struggling with these things, the first step is to accept who you are. Some people have physical abnormalities. You just have to accept who you are. Either way, that's who you are. You can deny it, you can run from it, but either way, that doesn't change who you are. Now, I'm not saying you shouldn't change and try to better yourself. You should try and change and better yourself, but you should accept who you are. I am a very awkward-looking guy. I've got a huge neck and a very, very big receding hairline. I have a very small, oddish body. I look kind of like this from a side angle. I've got my long, awkward neck. Then there's this awkward belly that comes out of nowhere, and then there's a non-existent butt, and then the legs. You just have to accept who you are. Some of us have to have a little bit harder of a time, but denying that reality, it just makes it harder in the end run, and it makes it harder to find yourself. And trust me on this one, you will have a hard time trusting God for the rest of your life if you do not accept how you are. Now, I know that it brings up a lot of questions like, how could a good God create something like that? Absolutely, I understand that these are questions that go through our minds. But the truth is that we are not God. And God didn't make us sin. But because there is sin in the world, there's decay and there's frailty and there's things that aren't supposed to be like that. But have hope, because our life is only a very small part of our existence. And once we go to the new heavens and the new earth, we're going to be given a resurrected body. And things won't be like they are now, and your insecurities won't be like they are now. And so remember in that and trust in that. And so besides accepting who you are and how you are, you don't have to get married. There's no standard. I know people nowadays think that if you're not in a sexual relationship that your life is pointless. But the truth is, having kids doesn't define you, and neither does having a spouse. You don't have to get married. There's nothing written in the stars that you have to get married. I mean, it's just not like that. Marriage doesn't make you complete. If you are addicted to pornography, and you get married, you will still look at pornography when you're married. If you have self-image issues and you get married, you will still have self-image issues. You may be distracted for a time, but there comes a point in your life where you're still going to have to face that. You're still going to have to face the demons in your closet. Now, obviously, as a Christian, we believe that God takes us as we are, broken and frail, but he doesn't leave us there. He fixes us, and he works in us. So, whereas physically, you might have to endure things like having partially developed male and female organs your entire life. You might have to endure something like that. I'm not going to say that this is going to be an easy issue. You might have to endure something that's not fair and not the standard. It's not fair that people should resent God when he had nothing to do with us sinning. He gave us a choice and we chose. That's not his fault. It's not fair that he should be held to our mistakes. Life is full of unfair circumstances. And God is more concerned with developing our character than giving us all a perfect existence. You can see that by the fact that there's people in Africa who are in civil war. You can tell that by the way that there are people in China and whatnot who can only have, obviously the rules change and whatnot, but at least for a time could only have one child and had to, you know, do away with the second child. You know, that's not overly fair. It's not fair that, you know, people should have to have a constitution to tell them that they have rights. People should just have rights. There is unfairness that exists in the world. That's the problem. You know, there is a problem. To deny it would be unchristian and just illogical. So, there is that. And then I also want to say this. Seek God and find yourself in Him. If you look inside yourself to find yourself, you're going to find a big hole, a bunch of nothing. If you look to the world to define you, you're going to get more and more confused, and you're not going to know head up from down. You're going to know what other people think is right, not what is right. You know, back in the day, you know, it wasn't uncommon for a, you know, 40-year-old guy to marry, you know, a 15-year-old girl, but nowadays that's very much so frowned upon. Back in the day, it wasn't that big of a deal to have a slave, but now that's very much so frowned upon. So, I mean, there's things that change, and cultures sometimes accept things and sometimes don't accept things. And unless you want to say that it's okay to do those things in the Middle East but not here, which doesn't make sense, in which case there's no reason to prosecute anyone because it's just based on our own culture, then you have to admit the fact that, you know, there is that. So you seek God and you find yourself in Him. You know, God changes us and He changes the standard and He helps us, you know, the human standard, I mean. He is the standard. And so it helps us to, you know, to find ourselves in seeking Him. And so although we are all faced with our own unique problems, we all have to make the decision to seek after God and find yourself in Him. Don't let the culture define who you are. Don't let your own reasoning define who you are. Let God give you His peace and help you to find yourself in that. Now, with that being said, I want to close with this. This is a very difficult issue, and there is no easy answer. That's just something that has to be admitted, has to be addressed. And with all that, Christians need to remain accepting and loving without condoning immorality. Just because you are struggling with feelings of transgender or whatnot does not mean that allows you the right to have sex with someone you're not married to who's not of the opposite gender. That does not give you a right to lust in your heart after people. That doesn't give you a right to go for male and female. That doesn't give you a right to be bisexual, to be lesbian, to be, you know, homosexual or whatever. That doesn't give you a right to do that. There is still a standard of morality as a Christian. Now, once again, we can't go to the world and expect for them to act like the like Christians. We have to meet the world on their level, basically, right? Discipleship is about meeting somebody where they are and helping them to take their journey towards spiritual maturity. We don't treat a non-Christian like they're already spiritually mature because that's just nonsense. You know, God is the one who does the work. We are not the Holy Spirit. And so we have to accept people. We have to love on people, okay? That's just how that has to go. That's what God has placed us here. Go into all the world and make disciples. You know, do this thing that I told you. But He doesn't say, go into all the world and tell people how sexually confused they are. Go into all the world and, you know, judge people and make them feel like they're not worthy. Go into all the world and make people feel like they can never, ever, ever get the help that they need. What about when a teenager has premarital sex and gets pregnant? Are you going to help her? Or are you going to tell her how wrong it was for her to have premarital sex? So, I mean, like, there comes a point where morality is good, but, and the law is good. But if it's used unlawfully, it kind of does away with its whole purpose. You know, if we're not living by the standard of grace that God has given to us, how can we possibly expect someone else to accept that same standard? So with that being said, you know, there is a standard of truth. There is a standard of right and wrong. But one more thing needs to be said, and that's, you know, although we're acknowledging that there is an abnormal physical development, and sometimes there are abnormal mental illnesses and whatnot, and we are acknowledging the fact that there are, you know, transgender kind of things and whatnot, we're acknowledging that there is a physical abnormality. We are not condoning sexual immorality. Okay? So, just because you are sexually confused doesn't mean that you have a right to live as immoral. Okay, just because you have a physical defect doesn't mean that you are free from morality. You know, I really think that that's the heart of the issue, is people are trying to make it where, because I have this thing, I don't feel like I am, or I don't look like I should, that somehow that means I am the exception to the rule, and I can live as immoral. And there's only one standard for both people. You know, and with that being said, I also want to say that, you know, there's this idea that there's this physical standard of perfection that some people have and some people don't. But the truth is, all people are broken and dying. Literally, all people. If you see someone who looks like a rugged image of perfection, the truth is there's something there that's wrong. You know, and then we get older and we get things like cancer. Well, I was born if genetically correct. Well, yes, but we do still fall apart. We do still get sickness. You know, there was a guy, I'm going to butcher his name, but Nabil Qureshi was Islamic, and he converted to Christianity, wrote some books, and then got, I believe it was cancer, and died. Well, he was only like in his, I want to say, 30s. Well, that's not fair. That's what I'm saying. Like, there's this idea that floats around in our head that we're going to be able to achieve complete fairness according to our standards, and that's just not reality. It's just not reality. It's not fair that people born, that children born in Syria should have to put up with this war that they had nothing to do with. But it's reality. It's not fair that Americans should spend all their money on themselves rather than helping other people in need. But that's the way it is. Now, obviously, we can sit around and complain about the problem, or we can do something to fix it. And my purpose in this is not to make people mad. And if I have offended you, I am genuinely sorry. Too many Christians have focused on offending people and trying to achieve righteousness by offending people. And that's just an impossibility. If my purpose is to offend people and not to cause restoration to God's fellowship, then my purpose is in vain. That's just how it is. So I genuinely hope that I haven't offended you, and I hope that this helps you to find your sexuality, honestly. So